Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends in Canada and Austria. My name is Andrea Ganthaler and I'm a university assistant at the Department of Botany of the University of Innsbruck. I would like to thank the Austrian Cultural Forum in Ottawa and in particular Dr. Macho for the invitation to participate in this lecture series. It's my great pleasure to talk about the current status and the future of mountain forests and the stress factors that are facing our forests. My own research focuses on the ecophysiology of plants. I'm interested in the stress factors that limit plant growth and survival, particularly in extreme habitats like high alpine sites. Main research activities deal with the structural and functional adaptations of trees to withstand drought and heat and pathogen attack. In this presentation, I will take you on a journey through global forests, with main stops in Austrian and Canadian forests. And I will address the current status and the importance of forests, discuss the impact of various stress factors on forest trees, and give an overview on ongoing and expected climate change-driven intensification of stress impact. Insights into ongoing research activities will illustrate the relevance of the topic and the importance of further intensification of research efforts in this field. Forests are an important element that shapes our planet. Forests cover about 31% of the global land area, and trees occur almost in all land parts, which are not limited by either very low temperatures or very low water supply. Forests fulfill important functions, or in other words, they provide several ecosystem services. Just to mention a few, they are home to most of Earth's terrestrial biodiversity, as trees shape other components of the ecosystem, such as micro and macro faunal and floral diversity. Forests supply water. They provide food and various wood products. And they are a significant economic factor. Importantly, forests mitigate climate change by acting as important carbon sinks and buffering a part of the emitted CO2. They are also important for the human well-being. A decrease in forest area can lead to increased human health problems, such as respiratory diseases. One function of forest that is particularly important for mountain region is the protective effect for settlement, infrastructure, and inhabitants against several natural risks, such as avalanches, rockfalls, and landslides. In alpine regions, we strongly depend on the functions forests provide, and the protective effect is of enormous economic importance. There is thus a strong interest to preserve healthy forests. Depending on the exact definition, up to 1/3 of all natural forests worldwide can be classified as mountain forests. Trees occur up to the elevational tree line, which represents the upper limit of tree growth. High elevation forests are characterized by harsh environmental conditions and are very sensitive to climate change. They are thus of special interest for a country like Austria. Austria is a country rich in forests. Forest land has increased for decades to about 47% of the whole Austrian territory. For Europe, the average is 42%. If we compare Austria with Canada, the forest cover in trees per square kilometers for both countries is very similar, with about 32,000 to 36,000 trees per square kilometer. However, due to the varying population densities, Austria has about 360 trees per person, while Canada is one of the leaders with about 9,000 trees per each inhabitant. With respect to the tree species composition, Austrian forests are dominated by a conifer, namely Norway spruce, while broadleaf species such as beech, oak, and ash are less present. But how is the situation on a global scale? Are forests at risk today? While forest area increased or is expected to remain stable on some continents, in certain parts of the world, the forest area is expected to continue declining. Especially natural or near-natural forests in South America and Africa are decreasing due to illegal deforestation and shifting cultivation. But apart from human-induced deforestation, also large-scale tree mortality can affect forest ecosystems and their functions. And this problem affects all forests on a global scale. Generally, tree mortality is a natural phenomenon that occurs at a very low rate in all forest populations. Large-scale tree mortality can be caused, on one hand, by catastrophic events, such as hurricanes, landslides, and fires. On the other hand, for several massive tree mortality events in the last decade, abiotic and biotic stresses have been identified as major drivers. Abiotic stress is the negative impact of non-living factors, such as water limitation and extreme high or low temperatures. Living organisms such as viruses, bacteria, fungi, or harmful insects can cause biotic stress. Trees are particularly affected by recurrent stresses due to their long life cycle. Such stress-induced tree mortality events are reported from different parts of the world and will now be discussed in detail. Abiotic stress factors with the most significant impact on forest health are drought and heat. Both often occur in combination during summer heat waves, and several studies report massive tree mortality events caused by long heat waves without precipitation in the last decade. This didn't occur only on extremely dry sites, but applied to a wide range of forests. Also, some of the most important tree genera were heavily affected. For example, in Europe, large-scale drought-induced pine mortality was observed for areas in Switzerland and Spain, but also in Austria. While in Canada, severe drought-induced mortality of aspen was observed, often in combination with outbreaks of defoliating insects. Drought and heat-induced tree mortality is definitely an emerging climate change risk for forests, which also applies to mountain forests, even though potentially to a lesser extent. Water limitation decreased the growth of trees and thus reduced forest productivity and quality of forest products. And reduced forest vitality negatively affects also other ecosystem services, such as their protective function in mountain regions. Also, biotic stresses caused by insects and bacteria or fungi are significant threats to the forest sector. They were found to be one of the most important, or even the most important cause of forest disturbance in the Northern Hemisphere, and particularly in temperate forests. For example, for North America, large outbreaks of spruce budworms were reported. And in Europe, spruce bark beetles are a serious problem. In addition, there are several defoliating insects, harmful bacteria, fungi, and also plant viruses that endanger individual tree species. Insects, like bark beetles, are among the most significant problems of the past decades, as they clearly profit from higher temperatures. Higher temperatures enables more cycles of propagation and thus favor major outbreaks. There is thus broad agreement that climate change will lead to increased blast frequency and intensity, but also to a change in distribution and range of forest pathogens. Also, an increased prevalence of new invasive pathogens was observed. As a result, several scenarios predict a substantial increase in forest area that is affected and damaged by biotic stress. One important aspect that usually gets less attention is the complex interaction between multiple stresses. Trees are often exposed to simultaneous or consecutive stresses. The most important stress interaction causing the highest damage is probably the combination of drought stress with pathogen attack. Such stress interaction will become more relevant, as all scenarios of climate predictions indicate major changes in temperature and precipitation within the next century. On one hand, warmer weather can have also positive effects on forests, as higher temperatures may increase plant growth in currently wetter and colder areas such as boreal forests. But on the other hand, weather extremes such as drought and excessive high temperature will cause major losses and may probably offset any gain in productivity. In addition, the vulnerability of trees to stresses may increase. The extent of positive and negative effects of climate change with respect to tree growth, in any case, will vary with the level of the stress and the tree species. In conclusion, climate change aggravates the adverse effects of stresses and increases growth reductions and mortality risks. Therefore, it is important to better understand the physiological mechanisms of tree damages and mortality, the response mechanisms of trees to stress, and the varying resistance between and within populations. I will present now one research project in detail that addresses fungal infections of conifer trees in the Alpine region. Norway spruce trees in high elevation forests of the Alps are frequently infested by needle bladder rust. This fungus infects the newly sprouting needles in spring and leads to a distinct, far visible yellow discoloration during summer. At the end of summer, needles attacked by this forest pathogen are shed by the tree, leading to almost bar twigs in years with high infection intensities. This forest pathogen does not directly lead to tree death, but affects forests that have an important protective function. It is thus of high regional relevance and a really good example to present scientific and methodological approaches for better understanding of forest diseases. It also demonstrates that basic research can represent a basis for development of innovative and sustainable strategies to preserve healthy forests. Needle bladder rust is limited to high alpine forests because the obligate parasite undergoes a complex life cycle with a host shift between two plants. And besides spruce trees, needs rhododendron shrubs for overwintering. And these rhododendron shrubs mainly occur at high alpine sites. By formation of a high amount of spores, the fungus can spread several kilometers, enter the spruce needles, and form, after several months of grow, new spores that again infect rhododendron shrubs. Needle rust infections and the subsequent needle loss can have several negative consequences for affected trees, including anatomical, morphological, and physiological modifications. The first effect is a significantly reduced photosynthetic activity and net photosynthesis rate, mainly caused by a reduction of the chlorophyll content and dysfunctions in the photosynthetic apparatus. Reduced photosynthesis, in turn, leads to restricted biomass accumulation, which results in reduced tree growth. Infected trees thus remain smaller, and the stem shows lower radial increment. This limited root formation can result in reduced timber yield and therefore economic losses. However, even more critical for mountain forests is the negative effect of the fungus on seedlings and young trees. Frequently, cripple growth and even tree dieback can be observed in young forest stands. And foresters report increasing difficulties in both natural regeneration and afforestation of high alpine sites. Research approaches now focus on naturally occurring trees with enhanced resistance. The susceptibility to the fungus can vary substantially between individual trees, and in rare cases, an apparently healthy tree can be found in the middle of a heavily affected stand. Based on these observations and in cooperation with several partners, we are striving to elucidate the response and resistance mechanisms of these trees. One important objective is the identification of genetic and chemical characteristics of this resistance, but also the quantification of growth benefits and the influence of climatic factors on the disease severity. Together with an improved monitoring system, these approaches can help to identify and reproduce resistant plant material that would be really helpful for forestation of highly affected sites. Monitoring, for example, can be improved by the use of unmanned aerial vehicles, which have a great potential for the detection of forest diseases, particularly in hardly accessible terrain like in alpine sites. They enable to extend the survey area and provide timely and flexible monitoring with a high spatial ground resolution. In combination with a newly developed image analyzing method, the percentage of yellow infected needles can be accurately determined for individual branches or entire tree crowns. This innovative method can help to monitor year-to-year and site-specific differences in infection intensities, and compared to visual assessment, is very precise and objective. Selected trees with enhanced resistance can be reproduced in a conventional way by collecting seeds and raising seedlings. Or cuttings are generated by rooting of twigs. This latter method has the advantage to generate genetically identical clones, and the chance that generated cuttings show similar characteristics as the mother trees are really high. Such cuttings of resistant trees are currently raised at our research site in Tyrol and are subjected to controlled infection to test the resistance. Naturally occurring resistant trees are a really good example confirming that genetic diversity is highly relevant and a valuable resource for selecting plants that are adapted to high stress intensities and in general future conditions. But a higher diversity is not only desirable at the genetic but also on the species level. Currently, conifers dominate Austrian forests, but a higher percentage of broadleaf species and mixed forests could enhance the resilience to changing climatic conditions. Stand diversification, together with targeted interventions and forest management strategies, such as thinning and shorter rotation age, could avoid the intensification of stresses in forests. We can conclude that biotic and abiotic stress factors have a high economic and ecological importance for forests, will increase due to climate change, and may contribute to global decline of forest area and reduction of quality and quantity of forest products and services. It is therefore essential to intensify research activities which help to identify adapted species or genetic varieties to future conditions, and in this way support the preservation of stable and healthy forests. Before concluding my talk, I would like to thank all persons, institutions, and scientific funds supporting and enabling my ongoing research activities. And I hope that you can enjoy in your free time some really nice excursions to the local forests, and maybe at some point also in Austria. Thank you very much and greetings from Innsbruck.